Kids, you are dismissed. There is a crew ready and waiting for you. But youth, you're staying. But kidsmen, you can leave. Okay. Good morning, everybody. Huyamora. Sambonani. Absheni. Dumelan. Bom dia. All right. Good morning, everybody. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Just want to give a special welcome. Do we have any first-time visitors here this morning? Any first-time visitors? Welcome. All right. Keep your hand up. We've just got a little something for you. Oh, right here as well. Right here. Lots of first-time visitors. Welcome today. Today's a special Sunday. It is our Sinani Sunday. Sinani is one of our main outreach branches of Church Unlimited, where we go into our communities and minister via the orphans and vulnerable children there, sharing the love of Jesus. We have some more visitors this side. In the middle here, we have many today. Welcome, welcome. So you've joined us on a special Sunday. We'd love to get to know you. So at the end, taps right over here. At the end of our service, feel free to come to the back in the welcome area. We'd love to meet you and introduce ourselves to you all of you first-time visitors. Okay, we've got a couple announcements this morning. So tomorrow is the start of our Bible Life. Is the video ready for us this morning? Great. So Bible Life kicks off tomorrow, and we will let the video do the talking.
God wrote, "I love you." He wrote it in the sky and on the earth and under the sea. He wrote his message everywhere because God created everything in his world to reflect him like a mirror. And God put it into words too and wrote it in a book called the Bible. The Bible isn't a book of rules or a book of heroes. The Bible is most of all a story. There are lots of stories in the Bible, but all the stories are telling one big story. The story of how God loves his children and comes to rescue them. It takes the whole Bible to tell the story, and at the center of the story is Jesus. Every story in the Bible whispers his name. He's like the missing piece in a puzzle, the piece that makes all the other pieces fit together, and suddenly you can see a beautiful picture.
God has given us a letter which is really contained in an economy of words. You know, it's one thing, the stories in the scripture and so on, but it's also getting the background into which those stories are set, in which they are related. And once one has a better idea of those things and you're able to understand historically and so on and all the other things which are going around, you come to a much greater depth and understanding of the Word of God. And without it, one is really handicapped in many respects, in many ways.
If you have a Bible, I'd like to ask you to open up to Mark chapter 10.
You can open up your Bibles along at Hebrews chapter 4 and John chapter 1.
And it's from Luke 24. It's a passage that you all know very well, I'm sure.
Sometimes this amazing letter that God has written to us can seem inaccessible, confusing, frustrating, or even boring. We invite you to join us on a journey of unlocking God's big story, of understanding his letter written to each one of us. As we do this, God reveals himself to us in new ways. And as we learn about his message, it impacts on our ability to live his message. As the books of the Bible come alive in our hearts, we find their relevance in our daily lives. Know your Bible, live your Bible. Bible life. Look out for our clusters of classes and work through the Bible with us. Each course advertised runs for 3 weeks, one session per week. To cater for your particular availability, we run evening classes and morning classes. The sessions are also increasingly becoming available on DVD for your home viewing.
So our course in White River is just in the evening this particular session. It's 3 weeks long. If you haven't signed up and you're interested, please sign up in the back so you can start tomorrow evening. Also, the next Sunday, we have a special evening. It's our prayer and worship evening. We'd love for you all to come. Every one of you are invited, whether you've been here for the first time today or whether this is your 100th time. It looks a little different in our evening. We still have our morning services, but it's a special time where we move the chairs, we just freely worship our King, we pray over whatever the Lord has kind of put on our hearts and on the leaders' hearts. So please, we invite you to that next Sunday at 6 o'clock. And then the following Sunday, if you want to diarize this, it's the 11th of September, and we're having a special Family Sunday. And it's a special day in the life of the Church of CU White River. It's a time where we can come together and get to know each other a little bit more than maybe the 15 minutes over a cup of coffee or a cup of tea after the church service. You can bring your picnic basket. We'll have braai available. We'll play games. It's just a great time. So bring your family, bring your lunch, and come join us. Thank you. Over to Craig.
All right, check. I'm on, I think. Thank you, Josh. When you're hosting and preaching, you need help. So, welcome, everybody. How about that worship? Was that not amazing? Yeah, it was very special. And just for some of you that don't know, two of the members on that worship team are actually a part of Sinani. Wanda, who is up here, kind of organized that team. He does the marimba. He oversees all of the Sinani music stuff. And so we're very blessed to have him here. And we're thankful that he organized the team. And Janae does our slides that you see up here for Sinani whenever we have things going on. So yeah, there's more going on than just the worship. We're connected as a family. And well, Deidre is part of the woodwork. So Deidre was up here as well. And so welcome to the new folks. Today it looked a little different than, I guess, other days, but last week looked a little different too. And we're celebrating culture. We had Afrikaans songs last week. This week we had some more culture into what we have. We don't say we're just one culture, we're kingdom culture. And so we welcome that. And so if you haven't heard, my name is Craig Rebro. I'm one of the elders here at Church Unlimited White River. It's exciting, Sinani Sunday. The title of my message today is The More, and that's referring to the more of God. And I keep feeling God has more for us, and my goal today is to show you he has more for you. But before we jump in, I just want to acknowledge what God's doing in the church. There's been a hunger to go deeper this year at least, and even before that. And we've seen the evidence of that in baptisms. We've seen the evidence of that in salvations and the yearning for the Holy Spirit. And all these things are amazing. Lives are changing. People are living free. And as Leon preached 2 weeks ago, I think it was, well, what's next? And I'm going to park it there for a minute. And for the new folks, we have a pastor, he leads this church, his name is Guy. So when I say Guy, it doesn't mean like a guy. It means Pastor Guy. Or he probably, this isn't like me even calling him that. But just if I reference Guy in a sermon, that means it's Guy that leads this church. And Leon is another elder here who also preaches. So just to make sense of what I'm saying. And so Guy, you may have heard him speak about his upbringing in Christianity, and he said he's always been a church mouse, just wanted to be in the church and be involved in everything in the church. And then you may have heard of Leon speak about his upbringing and that Christianity was a very normal thing in his house, and even mission trips to Botswana. He showed pictures on the screen of him being about this big, in playing in the biggest, what did he say, the biggest sandbox in Botswana while they're on mission trips. And for me, it wasn't like that. I attended a Catholic school from grade 3 to 5, and it was more really because the school I went to was really rough, and this was a safer option for me. Pretty much opposite of Leon and Guy, I didn't go to church regularly as I was growing up. And my experience with evangelical Christians started about when I was age 10, I think. We moved to an area where there was a missionary family living right next door to us. In the States, there's side-by-sides, they're called. So like an apartment with a shared wall. So we literally were living right next to this family. And this family had adopted two Guatemalan orphans. And then we realized there was five more families down the way that moved there specifically to form a Christian community. And it was kind of weird because in that area in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, we weren't in the Bible Belt. And so evangelical Christians, it's very Catholic, very different, nothing against denominations, but I'm just saying the reality is that's what it was. So they speak Christianese, which kind of felt odd to us. And there was, I remember one time my dad lost his job and there was a knock at the door. And when he opened the door, there was 15 people standing there saying they wanted to pray for him and lay hands on him. And in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, if you lay hands on someone, it means something very different. So my dad didn't want hands laid on him because that was fighting words, actually. So I think he politely said no thanks and he shut the door. And I do remember another time I was in the backyard and we had, where I'm from, there's snow. Snow gets deep, but it's fun when you're a little kid. You can go play in the snow and build stuff. And I was playing outside and one of the Guatemalan orphan, I guess, or adoptee was outside playing. And I'm pretty sure that the parents were still in the all grace, no discipline stage of their adoption because this kid was a terror. Like he was always being naughty. So I'm sure you know what a shambok is. He was swinging a large stick, even longer than a shambok. And he was swinging it at me. And I said, stop it. And he kept doing it. It was, hey man, stop that. And he smacked me in the face. When it's winter in Wisconsin and you get hit in the face, it hurts. It always hurts when you get hit in the face, but this especially hurt. And I remember looking back and I saw my dad in the window and he gave me the nod. So I went after this kid. And I remember the mom screaming, ah, stop it. My dad standing at the door. I don't know if he was smiling, but that's the way I just remember him at the door. And so, my evangelical Christian experience growing up was I beat up a Guatemalan orphan. There is a side note here. I think that those neighbors could have taken a chapter out of 1 Corinthians 9 about meeting people where they're at to win people for Jesus. Because it was kind of weird coming to the door with, 15 people. And you shouldn't beat up missionary kids. So my point is this. If you think you aren't prepared for the mission field or to serve in the church, either was I. Being a missionary was the last thing on my mind growing up. And now I'm standing up here in South Africa in front of you. And so that's a little background for you. And I was just hoping that would get your attention. So since the beginning of the year, or even before that, we've been doing a lot of equipping. We've had Bestseller, the Gifted series. We've been preaching a lot about Holy Spirit. And we're learning about what's next. Many of us have been freed of stuff. People being freed of unforgiveness. Chains of bondage falling off from addictions. And people being healed from ailments. And much of what we've been doing feels like preparation. So today, I'm here to tell you, practically, what you've been preparing for. And as the video said, can you turn to your Bibles to Ephesians 5, verse 8 through 14? Or scroll to it. Ephesians 5, 8 through 14. And it'll be on the screen behind me. I'm reading in the Passion Translation, which I normally don't, but it makes the point. Once your life was full of sin's darkness, but now you have the very light of our Lord shining through you because of your union with him. Your mission is to live as children flooded with his revelation light. And the supernatural fruits of his light will be seen in you, goodness, righteousness, and truth. Then you will learn to choose what is beautiful to our Lord. And don't even associate with the servants of darkness, because they have no fruit in them. Instead, reveal truth to them. The very things they do in secret are too vile and filthy to even mention. Whatever the revelation light exposes, it will correct. And everything that reveals truth is light to the soul. This is why the scripture says, "Arise, you sleeper. Rise up from your coffin, and the Anointed One will shine his light into you." So what's this scripture saying to us? We were once in darkness, and as people who have light from the Lord, our actions should reflect our faith. And now we learn to choose what is beautiful to our Lord. And Guy mentioned it. There's the reference. Not a guy. Guy mentioned it last week. Things like justice and to love people, those are beautiful to the Lord. Verse 14 in the NIV says it this way, "Wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." You see, Paul was reminding the Ephesians to wake up and realize the dangerous condition into which some of them had been slipping. They were missing the more. But what it says is once you are awake and alive, you don't have to do things on your own. Jesus will be with you. Christ will shine on you. And I feel as a church, we're not sleeping anymore. We've got out of our coffins, and the Lord is ready to use us and to shine on us. So John 15, verse 16, if you want to turn to it, you can, but it will be on the screen. It says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last." And when we are appointed to something, it means we are selected or assigned. It also means ordained or to purpose. The Greek word for appointed is tethemi, and it means to set forth or to make for one's use. My boy Andrew, he's my youngest, just started his first year in university last week. And the picture I get of him relating to this, to set forth, is to release him. But we don't just release things, do we? We release them so they can go do something specific. If I release a dove and I expect it to fly when I do this, I do expect it to fly. If I don't, it just falls with a thud. So there is an expectation, right? And based on everything I've said so far, it's evident that Jesus expects us to do stuff. And this is a reminder that our faith is not just about us, it's about others as well. But there's something called free will. And we can accept or reject Jesus' offer. If we reject it, we won't experience the more of God. We will not fly, we'll thud. And I have to tell you, that's why I'm so passionate about this topic, because I have experienced the more of God, and Jesus wants the same for you. As I was preparing, I was in the book of Haggai, and I want to share from it. So this one, if you can turn to, it's Haggai chapter 1, 4 through 6, and then in 9. It says, "Is it a time for you yourselves to be living in your paneled houses, while my house remains in ruin?" And in the King James, it says, "dwelling in sealed houses." And that means every reference to sealed houses in the Bible has to do with wealth. It means beautiful wood, often made of cedar. Verse 5, "Now this is what the Lord Almighty says. Give careful thought to your ways. You have planted much, but harvested little. You eat, but never have enough. You drink, but never have your fill. You put on clothes, but are not warm. You earn wages only to put them in a purse with holes in it." Verse 9, "You expected much, but see, it turned out to be little. What you brought home, I blew away. Why, declares the Lord Almighty? Because of my house, which remains a ruin, while each of you is busy with your own houses." I realize this is exactly what was going on in my life in 2008. Brendan and I were asked to be a partner in a business deal to build a spec house. And at the time, that was a trend when inventory was low, interest rates were low, and if you built a house, you could quickly turn that into profit, basically. And our friends had done it multiple times. They said, ah, you can't lose. Well, we lost. We didn't pray about that decision. And it went wrong, like horribly wrong. And like the Jews, they were tasked with rebuilding the temple, and God was asking them to do something, trying to get their attention. But they were busy trying to make beautiful homes instead. And I realized that's what we were doing. In my study notes, it says this. They had not given God first place in their lives, and their work was not fruitful or productive, and their material possessions did not satisfy. While they were concentrating on building and beautifying their own homes, God's blessing was withheld because they no longer put him in first place. Jobs, homes, vacations, and leisure activities may have ranked higher of the list of importance than God. This was the case for me in my life at the time. I went to church, but if any of those things like jobs, homes, vacation, leisure activities came up as an opportunity, I would have had no problem putting those first. And all I'm saying is God was trying to get our attention as we were chasing after other things. And he blew away those things we were chasing. The good news? The Jews did end up completing the temple through the ministry of Haggai and Zechariah. They urged the people to put their priorities in order. And God did the same for us in our situation. So you might be asking, where's this practical stuff you were talking about? Well, it's summed up in Luke 10:27. You've heard this verse over the last few weeks. It says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your strength and all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Love God, love people. That's the practical. And here's what that looks like. Some practical examples. This was a couple Fridays ago here serving 40 care workers. This is our church serving. That's loving God and loving people, in my opinion. It's about taking the first step. And the more of God comes when we do his will, his way. Blessings flow, and I'm not saying to serve God because of blessing. I'm saying to serve him because you are appointed. You were chosen so you can bear fruit. That's God's plan for us, and through that you will be blessed. And I want to give you a couple of examples of lives being positively changed. And practically, like real examples, there was a team that was here a couple months back. They served with Sinani for about 2 weeks, and they've given me permission to share. And these quotes, I'm sure, weren't what these people thought was going to happen when they came to serve. Because I was in those meetings when we planned, and it was a lot more about the logistics and planning. But here's what actually happened. The first one is from a guy named Tom. It says, my heart was encouraged and broken at the same time, seeing the lives that are being positively changed. The trip allowed me to hear the Holy Spirit speaking to me clearer than I have ever heard him before, and to take the next steps of healing in my journey from the wounds of my past, and focus more on his plans he has for me now. The second one is from a lady named Jo. And says, I think the most valuable thing I carried home from me from South Africa was a humbled heart, so much more open to the power of the Holy Spirit, so much more aware of the God who lives in me. So when people ask me what South Africa was like, I tell them amazing and humbling. And when they ask why, I tell them because God is at work there. Guys, this is what you are invited to. This is the more. I was speaking to someone last week, and he was telling me about a man from Hungary. He's not Hungary. He's Hungarian. So he's traveling from Hungary, Europe. People laughed the first time. So he's from Hungary. He's from Europe, and he travels the world. And he said this. I don't think he was a Christian, but here's what he noticed about this country. He said, South Africans seem to have confidence and conviction for God that is different from any other place in the world. Church, we have something very special here. People travel across the globe to see what God is doing in this country. The enemy doesn't want you to see that. They want you to focus on ESCOM and striking and all these things. But there's something very special that goes on in this area. So let's come alongside God. Let's do the amazing things. Let's do what people travel 9,000 kilometers to experience. So what's the more of God? I think it says Jesus first, which is right. Yes, a vibrant relationship with Jesus. It's experiencing his love in your life in unexpected and amazing ways. It's living a life that satisfies your soul. It's developing beautiful relationships with people you would have never known. It's being used by God through the Holy Spirit to do miraculous things. And it's living a rich life that will leave a legacy. Did you notice I didn't say anything about financial blessing? Can he bless you financially? He can. Absolutely. But that's not the point. For those of you that have been here, there was a team that came through. They were from all over South Africa. They're a professional worship team, and they came to bless this region, and we were out with them for about a week. They didn't ask us for a penny. All they wanted to do is come serve the Lord and spread the gospel in our communities, in the forgotten places. It was amazing. But when I was spending time with them, they said this. They said, we live by faith and God provides. In the years of full-time ministry that Brenda and I have been here, I've often wrestled with what motivates people to act. Over the years, we've had many events advocating for the vulnerable and the marginalized. And I could be wrong, but it seems like people get much more moved by rhino poaching than things that happen to people. And for those of you that know me, you know I love nature and God's creation. So please don't think I'm not a supporter of animal conservation. But when I read the scriptures, God doesn't seem to highlight animals as much as he highlights people, especially the poor and the vulnerable. And I'll give you just one verse out of 100 I found in the Bible related to this. Galatians 6:2. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. You see, God revealed something to me about this recently. People's hearts are stirred when they recognize absolute injustice. And I think that's why rhino poaching or animal cruelty seems to get more attention than social injustice. Animals can't defend themselves from people with a plan. And to me, that could be considered absolute injustice to kill an endangered species. But for some reason, I think that we feel human beings can avoid injustice, even if they are children, and that gives our hearts an out. If I could have you post the first one. So Sinani has about 1,100 followers, I guess. And if we post something that says, whoever is generous to the poor tends to love the Lord, and he will repay him for his deeds. In Proverbs 19:17. And I don't know if you can see that, but that had 12 likes. Can you go to the next one? So it's a cool picture, right? I got almost 100 likes on this one, and I have about the same amount of people. So there's no scientific study, but you can draw your own conclusions about what speaks to our hearts. But let's take this to the absolute extreme. What about a person willingly accepting and enduring injustice? That's almost unheard of, isn't it? That's Jesus. That's what he did for us. And his absolute nature and compassion for us should motivate us. In the absolutes is where our hearts are stirred to action. I think most of us are compassionate, but the tactic the enemy uses to suppress our compassion and to steal our joy is avoidance. Avoidance keeps us from being uncomfortable, but that can turn into apathy. And most of the time when we say yes to God, we're only uncomfortable for a short period. And then he comes alongside of us and he gives us what we need. And that's when the more happens. Avoidance does not allow the more of God to shine through in our lives. And this is why I want to encourage you to get involved somehow. It's not for our sake, it's for obedience' sake. And it's to honor God and to do his will, his way. It's so you can experience life in abundance. When people are obedient, lives are changed. And then there's fruit. So we're going to transition here. I'm going to invite Brenda up to show you about lives changed and fruit. And then we're going to end with a video at the end.
I'm going to ask my dear girl, appreciate. You ready? Oh, come on, you can do it. I'm going to invite someone very special up to share. She shared so well for a service. You got this, girl. I'm with you. You got this. I'm going to pray for you. Okay? Join me in praying for her. Oh, Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for appreciate. We thank you what you've done in her life. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you indwell in her. We pray that you'd give her boldness. Pray that you would rise up in her and she would be able to just preach and share exactly what it is that you've done in her life with boldness and courage because of what you've done for her. In Jesus' name, amen.
You got this. I'll hold your hand again.
Hi, guys. My name is Appreciate, and I want to share my testimony with you. So before I got...
Can we hold it?
Before I got involved with church, I would go sometimes because my mom forced me to. I didn't go there because of my own will. But as time went by, I got to understand what was being preached. So I wasn't fully involved in church. Like, I wasn't even myself. Like, I would be confused. Like, how are they understanding the Bible? Because I can't. So I went to the youth camp with some of the Sinani members, and while they were teaching us, I got to understand a bit, and I told Mom Brenda to pray for me because I can't understand the Bible like everyone else. So I had some beads around my waist because my grandma told me that I have a calling to be a sangoma. So while they were praying for me, I got rid of the beads and I got baptized. I became born again and I am 100% a certified child of God.
Amen. And
I can say that with God there's life, there's peace, there's joy, there's happiness, and with him, you can do anything you want, and he can do anything for you as long as you invite him to your life so he can take over. Thank you.
So one of the things Craig put up there, the more of God. It's beautiful relationships that people you would have never known. I wouldn't know Appreciate if I just stayed back in America. I wouldn't know her. I wouldn't know any of you. I think there's so many, so many ways the Lord has called us. And the more of God, like, I can't put into a message.
You just have to come, because the more of God for you will be different than the more of God for me. But you'll experience life in a different way. Sometimes you'll find yourself someplace with people speaking a different language, and all of a sudden you're like, how did I get here? But you realize that the Lord is with you, and there is just an anointing and a blessing and a covering over you in that time, and you know that that's the more of God. You don't need things to have the more of God. And so now we're just going to share a little video with you that shares about when people are obedient, when people step out and put themselves out there for others, the fruit of what can happen. I was speaking with Bernie, you guys know Ian and Bernie, yesterday, and we were chatting about a special message that Ian gave at CU Copsewip 5 years ago, and I was sharing with her how it spoke to us at that time. And she kind of knew a bit, and she said, Brenda, this is what I was telling you about yesterday, that there's going to be fruit that you don't even know about today, that 5 years from now, 10 years from now, you're going to see. Just like I spoke that to her, it was fruit in her life. And she said, when I share with Ian, it's fruit in his life that he didn't even know, the message that he was obedient to in 2017, how it is affecting the kingdom now. And so we'll show you a video about other people who've either had been obedient, or perhaps other people have been obedient, and there is fruit as a result of that obedience.
I woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble now. I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something?
It is special to me. It's because I'm giving back to the community. That makes it special. I was one of the orphans, grown up in a home-based care, in a center. Even though some, they think that, she's useless, she's an orphan, she's nothing, she won't make it. But there was those people around me who showed me love, who showed me care, who showed me that there's still hope with you. So I think this, what makes me love this job, that I'm bringing back whatever they did to me, now I'm bringing it back to the community. But what I just want to see our center being achieved, seeing all of my kids from the center going to school, the one who are in grade 12 just finished their matric and going to varsity, you know, just want to see that center to be life.
I'm not afraid to
So, we are inviting you. You are invited to come and experience the more of God. It will look different for each and every one of you, but we want to invite you. And one of the ways to experience the more of God is come join Sinani. There's many ways that you can get involved. From our team, we said, if we can get you to commit to three times, because you know what? What if on the first time you forgot your water bottle and it's 40 degrees outside, and then you think, ah, God hasn't called me, because you are uncomfortable. So we'll ask you to just challenge yourself. Make a commitment between you and the Lord to come out three times between now and the end of the year. I'm going to challenge you. Not, okay, 2023, we'll come then. No, we want to challenge you. Come out this year. Drop your comfort. Drop your prejudice. Drop your control, your security. Come join us. So the practical ways, we'll tell you a few things. You can come speak to us after the service, but some great ways to come and join us. We'd love to invite you to join on different ways, because then you'll kind of see where you feel you can slot in even longer. So we have another youth camp coming for Appreciate and the rest of the crew in December. We always need people to come and help, serve food and join us and pray. If sports is your thing, we have our Sinani Premier League. We have four more game days before the big championship game day. We'd love for you to come. We have various venues to come. Our guys are playing, but they need some fans to cheer them on. We also have netball. We have practical things. We've got a playground that needs to be finished in Elandshoek. We've got a door that needs to be installed for a young family. We'd love for you to join us on home visits. Do you guys know where Mshalozi is? Mshalozi's like just down the road. We have young kids that walk from Mshalozi to church on Sunday. So that tells you how far it is. Not very. Though it would be great if some people could pick them up on a Sunday. But it's so close. We've got a center where we can invite you in to come read to the kids. Do homework help for the kids. Listen to them play marimbas for you. So there's no excuse. We've got places from as close as Mshalozi. You can come see something very different out in Oakley, which is in Bushbuck Ridge area. We'd love to invite you to come and play a part. Come speak to one of us under the gazebo. Get in on our volunteer WhatsApp group and just come and see where God wants to use you. Just put yourself out there for him and he'll just steer you. And we'd love to see who knows what fruit will come of that in years to come. Thank you.
Okay, you can clap. Okay, so that looked a little different than maybe a regular Sunday, but I hope your hearts were stirred. I hope you realized that going is a benefit to others. It changes lives, but it also benefits you. And we honor God by doing it. So if we can, this concludes, but I'm just going to pray us out. Dear Lord, thank you so much that you've appointed us. Thank you that Christ's light shines upon us. Lord, I just pray that when we're released or we're set forth, that we don't just land with a thud, rather we fly. And I pray for protection as people go on their way. I pray for anyone who's hurting or has family members that are ill, we pray for them specifically in Jesus' name. If anyone needs prayer, please make your way up to the front. And if anyone wants to chat more about something that's stirred in you, there's lots of people other than Sinani, there's lots of people here that do other things that serve the Lord. So we'd be happy to channel, steer, plug you in. Oh, I thought Maria was raising her hand to say something. Sorry, she's just stretching. So that concludes today. Go and be blessed. Thank you.